Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Hey guys, I have a really neat interview for you today. Dr. J is over at the Courage Conference in Plymouth, Michigan. Really neat program and amazing healing work they're doing. I'll link to it in the write-up on our website. And she took time out from it to talk with Teresa Tomeo of Catholic Connection, who you've heard on here before. Teresa is interviewing Dr. J and Father Paul Check of the Diocese in Bridgeport, Connecticut, on how to work as a force for healing in the midst of all the sexual pressure our culture applies.
Welcome back. It's Catholic Connection. It's a Wednesday morning.
There it is.
There he is. Okay, Father.
I spoke out of turn.
It's live radio here, and we're live from Plymouth, Michigan at the beautiful conference that's been taking place since Monday evening, welcoming and accompanying our brothers and sisters with same-sex attraction. And wow, what an honor, two powerhouses. I am just so thrilled. Father Paul Check from Courage and my friend Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morrison. Aren't you glad, Jennifer, it's not 5 o'clock in the morning?
I am. It's great to be in the same time zone with you, Teresa.
And you're moving to the central time zone, so when you're on my show next time, it won't be as early.
It won't
See
be
that?
So bad. I'm so glad.
Yeah, God is good. Well, listen, so far, an amazing conference. I've learned a lot. Jennifer, let me go to you first. What do you think so far has been coming out of this conference in terms of dialogue, knowledge, information, all that good stuff?
Gee whiz, you know, the testimonials from the people who have themselves experienced same-sex attraction and who have struggled with it in various ways, that's been very fruitful, I think, because each one of them has their own unique take on it, but they're all faithful to the church in their respective ways. There's something going on now that I wish I could be in there to hear, which is the conversation between Janet Smith and Eve Tushnet, and I haven't looked in on that. I don't know what that's what's going on there. But
well, we'll have
sure
another 30
be
minutes because we're done at 10, and we can all run in there. But you have another interview to do for Catholic View for Women.
That's
we're not letting you get off easy,
that's
sister.
Right.
When we have you, we're going to get as much as you as we can. One of the things I wanted to pick up on, and why I wanted to have you both on together, you're both in this fight. You're on the front lines, as most of us here are. But what I think is interesting about your message, Father, I loved your opening night address. I thought it was very powerful, and I really liked the way you spoke about identity. And the other point that you made that I think is so true, and this is what you're trying to do as well, Jennifer, is, Father, you hit the nail on the head in terms of with the voices out there in the culture on this issue, the people we're not hearing from are the Dan Matsons, the Robin right. Teresa Becks, the Raylenes, and the others yeah. who are, as you said, living out their faith and trying to be, you know, faithful like we all are to the yeah. church. And the victims of the sexual revolution are not heard. You're trying to get them heard. You're trying to get them heard.
Right. No, I think it's a very valuable voice. I think it's a compelling voice. And I think that in a culture that shows some deference to experience, no matter what that experience is, and then we have to value it and weigh it and see whether there is something useful there for us, It's a way to be able to build a bridge. I mean, it's never in the church's mind to draw a line that says, well, we can't talk to that group of people, or they're not interested in us, or we give up. Christ doesn't do that. So the question then becomes one of pedagogy. How do we share what we believe to be the compelling voice of Christ in the world with others so that they can have the opportunity to see the grace or to experience the grace that we have? And that to me is maybe a rough definition of charity, but I think that the voices to whom you're referring, Teresa, are voices that deserve a hearing because their experience is valuable, it bears on the topic, and it will appeal to some. Is it going to appeal to everybody? No. But will it appeal to some? Yes.
Is it being heard, do you think?
Not sufficiently. You referenced my talk the other night. Thank you for your gracious words. I began by saying that not quite a year ago in the Extraordinary Synod, when I was doing interviews, not unlike this one, I was just trying to get into the public forum the idea that this body of people exists. They're largely unknown. We don't hear from them very much, or just sort of in a closed sense, a community. we need to get that message further out. And so as the director of the apostolate, what I'm trying to do in the service to the church is say, here are these people, let me get out of the way, let put them center stage, and let them tell you, the world, the church, people in pastoral ministry, what's in their heart, what's in their experience, what's in their history, what's in their mind.
Yeah, and Jennifer, it reminds me of the victims that you talked to of the sexual revolution. You have a book on that, The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. And also, when you think about the women and men, Father and Jennifer, in the post-abortion movement, the healing movement, how they are silenced and they are mocked when they, and I'm there with them every year at the Supreme Court steps after we cover the March for Life. We march up there with them, and how they're ignored. And these are supposedly sister women, and we're all supposed to be, as you said, Father, about experience, and yet they're silenced in many ways.
You know, this is the pattern of the sexual revolution. The way the sexual revolution works is by silencing everybody who's been hurt by it. You know, it's supposed to be this long march of progress, and no victims, no downside whatsoever. And so the only way you can pull that off is to tell the post-abortive woman, no, you're not really having night terrors. No, you don't really have regrets 6 months after the fact. No, you don't have anniversary grief every year. That's not real. That can't be related to your abortion. And it requires telling men and women who are same-sex attracted, who wish to be rid of that, who wish to live a different way, that's not possible for you. I mean, we even shut down counselors. You know, we're now to the point where we're shutting down counselors.
Mm-hmm.
And what we have, what we're doing with the sex, with the whole, our whole project here at the Ruth Institute, victims and survivors of sexual revolution, is pointing out how many different groups there are like that. So children of divorce, same thing. There's no forum for children of divorce to say, hey, you know what, I wasn't really so resilient at all. Actually, you know, Mom, I mean, they can't even talk inside their own families.
Yeah.
They're silenced
children
even in their own families, you know, and that's
right.
The whole pattern. Without that, if the victims got a chance to speak, this whole thing would fall down.
Well, and I think it's true of children who have been raised in same-sex household.
Yep.
Those voices are not always welcome, but they should be heard. Children who are the product of in vitro fertilization,
they
have a story to tell. So your point about the effects and the consequences of a disordered, sinful way of life is going to be felt by innocent people who are touched by it in some way. And if we really have a search for wisdom, which is a word one of our presenters used, we should not be afraid to listen to other voices.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Let's take a quick break. Then I want to open up the phone line. So we have two amazing people in studio with us here. And we're on set in Plymouth, Michigan at the Courage Conference, welcoming and accompanying our brothers and sisters with same-sex attraction. Really don't need any introduction, but we are speaking with Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morth, Ruth Institute. And is this your latest book?
That's my latest book.
There you go. Look at you, girlfriend.
With Marilyn Monroe on the cover.
The Sexual Revolution and its victims. And, of course, Father Paul Check. You know him well from his amazing work at Courage Ministry, who opened up the conference with just a dynamo keynote speech. I learned a great deal. The other thing I want to talk about when we come back is the whole issue of identity.
Right.
Because what I thought, the point that you made, everybody can, no pun intended, identify with.
Sure.
I want to get to the phones. So we have Michelle from Grand Rapids who has a question. Michelle, how are you this morning?
I'm well, and I wish I could be here with you guys. My question is for Father Check. You had mentioned identity, and I didn't get to hear your opening speech, but this is something that I have been pondering lately because it seems like as a country we are really suffering from a true identity crisis. I mean, we have people who are pretending to be black when they're white. We have men who think that they're women when they're men. I just see it in even our children. So, I mean, I suspect we got there because we kind of jettisoned God and we don't know that we're his children, but how do you fix that?
Well, boy, that's a great question. My answer is going to be lack tremendously, but I agree with you that, and there's a line in Gaudium et Spes, which is the pastoral constitution on the modern world from the Second Vatican Council, which says that man essentially loses himself when he doesn't have the Creator, or he doesn't see the Creator, or he doesn't acknowledge the Creator. Then we don't know who we are. And St. John Paul II wrote a great deal about the philosophy of metaphysics, which is the science of being and the study of what something is. We don't know how to behave. We don't know what a good life is. We don't know where we will find fulfillment. We don't know the purpose of our lives if we don't know who we are. And in my talk the other night, I said I think the most important question ever asked in human history was the question Jesus poses to the apostles. Who do you say that I am? that leads to a particular answer, a confession of faith in Christ, but it's a foundational question. We walk up to people and say, at least in our mind, who are you? And we wait for them to tell us, and then we know what our relationship is going to be with them. How to change that? Well, first of all, it's deeply embedded in us to want to continue the search for self-knowledge. It can be painful, but it can also be, and it should properly be, liberating. Our Lord says the truth will set us free. And I think the bold proclamation of the gospel, which we need right now from Christians in the United States, that Jesus is Lord, that Jesus is the one who answers the question about what it means to be human, that's also in Gaudium et Spes, that is the church's way forward. Christ must stay at the center of this conversation and of the church's proclamation of the truth, and especially in our case as it touches sexual ethics.
Yeah, what Michelle asked was that I was going to bring up, Father, in mm-hmm. this whole identity point that you made with your opening talk on Monday night,
right.
That when you work with the people in Courage, mm-hmm. it's not so much, as you said, about sexuality, but, Jennifer, it is about identity.
Right. Right. Who am I?
Yeah.
Who am I? And we're selling ourselves so short when we think of ourselves in these kind of political categories. I mean, I've almost come to the conclusion that the term gay is a political category,
yeah.
you know, because it's a way of it's not simply a statement of this is who I am because I have these feelings. There's a lot of steps, logical leaps that one has to take between the statement, gee, I feel attracted to men, or I feel attracted to women, between that step and I'm gay, mm-hmm. with all that I'm gay means in our society today. There are a lot of steps you have to take there. It's not a no-brainer. It's not a obvious conclusion, and yet people are encouraged at very early ages to take
it. Well,
that
and that's a great point, Dr. Morris. How does a 13, 14, or 15-year-old
yeah.
young person resolve a very complex question like that?
Right.
I mean, how does someone who's in their late teens, in their early 20s, I'm 55, I said the other night, I am still coming to a deeper self-knowledge. I think we always will be that way in Christ. Isn't it true that in high schools, teachers and parents say, avoid putting people in categories or boxes, don't call them jocks, geeks, nerds, whatever the words are of today, because by doing that somehow you're doing harm to that person by labeling them?
Right.
So it's only in the sexual sphere, which, of course, is the subject of your work and mine, that somehow now this actually becomes a good.
Right.
And not something that hurts the person. And we're trying to find another way culturally.
We're creating
that.
More and more victims, though,
yes.
of this sexual revolution.
Well,
the fallout is just going to continue just be...
Teresa, that's such a great point. When people ask me about the Supreme Court decision and what I think and what does this mean, my first answer is it's going to lead to more suffering.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's mm-hmm. going to lead to more pain. It's going to lead to more confusion.
Yep.
That, I think, is going to be the ultimate effect of this. There's so much sentimentality, which I tried to also distinguish the other night. Sentimentality is superficial. It's not based on the truth. Compassion... neither do I condemn you, but now do not commit the sin
again.
I
loved your point about the adulterous woman. Go and sin no more.
There,
how many people forget that?
There is the truth which undergirds the compassion and makes sense of it. Sentimentality is disconnected from the truth, but we are a very sentimental culture. And adolescents, of course, I think, and I don't mean this in a bad way, are very vulnerable to sentimentality. So why should we do anything that would further along a tendency that can harm them? If we love them, we won't do that.
And, you know, one of the other things we're dealing with as a culture is that so many young people are already dealing with the pain of separation
right.
and rejection through their parents' divorces and through divorces throughout their family tree.
And so they're looking for love.
They're looking
for companionship. They're looking for connection.
Everybody's looking for reliable love
right.
and a sense of identity. And, you know, when you think about what a child's basic identity as a child of two particular people, your psychology, your inner being, depends very much on the stability of your parents' union. You know, and when your parents' union falls apart, that's very disruptive to people. Even if there are problems in the union, of course, there are always problems in people's families. There are always problems in the union. But when parents divorce, the child is forced to take sides quite often. It isn't unusual for children to be asked to perjure themselves in court on behalf of one parent and against the other. Even when parents try not to, they are rejecting the the other parent, well, that's half of who the child is, right? So so children of divorce have a very complicated set of things to negotiate psychologically.
And this will be true of in vitro fertilization, a fortiori. We've got now further confusion in the mind and heart of the child about where did I come from? What are my origins? In one of St. Thomas's works, he says the reason fornication is wrong is because everybody wants to know who their father is.
Mm. Is that right?
Wow. Yes. That's
Thomas says that?
He does in the Summa Contra Gentiles. And he's making an obvious point.
Oh, wow.
Biology or anatomy makes it a little more obvious, much more obvious, who the mother is. But because of, the way life comes to be, it's possible that we could not know. And there are a lot of birth certificates in the world, Sally, that say father unknown.
Yeah.
Well, we're out of time, but I can't thank you enough. Fascinating conversation. I'd like to have you both on for about 3 hours each.
You have a great show. We love it. We love it. Thank you.
And Dr. Jennifer Obeck Morse, thank you so much. God bless
you.
Stay strong and stay out there. And we'll talk to you tomorrow.
You're listening to Catholic Connection with Teresa Tomeo. Catholic Connection is a co-production of Ave Maria Radio and EWTN Radio.
You've just been listening to Dr. J, Father Paul Cech, and Teresa Tomeo speaking from the Courage Conference in Plymouth, Michigan. Courage International provides pastoral support to individuals experiencing same-sex attraction who wish to live in accordance with Catholic teaching on chastity and sexuality. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.